If you're interested in reading peer-reviewed research, it helps to have the conceptual framework for understanding these studies and the skills of reading and interpreting academic studies. The skills are something that will come over time, but what I'm trying to do in this video is to give you a conceptual framework that will help to build those skills more quickly. I use as my example here the research on learning because that's what I spend a lot of time reading. But if you're interested in a different topic, especially in the social sciences, you can probably substitute your topic every time that I say the word learning, and most of what I'm saying will probably still apply. The first thing to keep in mind is that the research on learning is just ridiculously diverse. Researchers study how people learn physical skills, how people learn to tell stories, how people learn to solve science problems, how people learn to read, how people remember words. The list just goes on and on and on and on. Researchers also use a variety of different methods. There are longitudinal studies where researchers follow learners over a long period of time as they get better at something. There is design-based research where researchers will design a learning experience and test it out among different people and then kind of iterate on that over time to improve it. There are experimental studies where one group of people goes through a learning experience and another group of people goes through a different learning experience, and then you get to look at the outcomes of those different experiences. There are quantitative studies, there are qualitative studies, there are studies that incorporate quantitative and qualitative methods together. There are laboratory studies that focus on isolating variables and focus on abstract materials. And there are applied studies using realistic materials in realistic scenarios. There's just a ton of stuff out there. In this video, I'm focusing on experimental designs. But if you're interested in other research methods, you can let me know in the comments. Before I get into the how to read part, I want to give a primer on experimental design so that you'll have some idea of like what this kind of research is trying to accomplish and how it works. Many experiments in psychology and in some other social science disciplines are structured in a similar way. For experiments in learning, we have at least two groups that go through two different learning experiences, and the researchers measure learning outcomes afterwards. In an ideal scenario, the only difference between the two groups was that they had these two different learning experiences. And so then the question becomes, what about these different experiences led to these different outcomes? A very common way to create comparable groups is through randomization. And what that means essentially is that any given research participant had an equal chance of being in each of the experimental groups. You might come across a study like this one. Both groups study the material for a little while, and one group of students is told to reread the material over the next, say, half an hour. And another group will do a different kind of thing, like maybe practice free recall, right? So they practice recalling what they read rather than rereading. Then both groups take the same test, which is the measure of the learning outcomes, and you get to see how did these different kinds of learning experiences influence the learning outcomes. One way to think about this is as a 2-by-1 design. You have two groups and you're comparing the outcome of those two groups. Each column or row represents a different learning experience, and because we're only focused on kind of one different variable, then we're just comparing two different experiences to each other. Now, in this example, we're comparing rereading to free recall, but it could be a lot of different things. It could be studying a worked example versus trying to solve an open problem. It could be getting feedback immediately versus getting feedback a few days later. Designs can get more complex. A 2-by-2 design is very popular as well, where researchers compare four different learning experiences to each other. This kind of design helps us to look at the interaction of different variables and explore how different variables affect each other. You might compare, for example, how much learning happens when playing a statistics game versus not playing a statistics game. And at the same time, you might compare how much learning happens from reading a passage on statistics concepts versus not reading a passage on statistics concepts. Here we're comparing four different learning experiences. In the upper left, we have a control group that didn't read the passage and didn't play a statistics game. In the upper right, we have a group that just played the game. And in the bottom left, we have a group that just read the passage. In the last experience, we have students who both read the passage and played the video game. We can see this lets us compare each variable to the control group, but critically, it also lets us compare the variables alone to the variables together. So that's my 2-minute explanation of experimental designs. Now let's get into the meat of how to read these articles. When we're reading research, the goal is not just to understand what the researcher is saying. The goal is to think about the value of the research and its connection to all of the other evidence that we have about something. To do this, we have to ask and answer questions about the research. And the first big question to ask is, why do this research? Why do it at all? The researchers themselves are trying to answer a question. And if you don't understand what that question is, it becomes very hard to interpret the research as a whole. Because scientific research is exploratory in nature, sometimes we end up answering a different question than we asked. But it's still generally a good idea to understand what the original question was, so you can understand why the researcher made the decisions that they did. And you want to think about questions like, what is the researcher reacting to? How are they seeing the world? And that's true even if you interpret what they are doing very differently than they interpret what they are doing. The research literature is just an ongoing structured conversation. And in the long run, the more that you read, the more that you understand the nature of that conversation. And knowing why the researchers are saying what they're saying is part of understanding that conversation. The purpose of this experiment might be to explore whether free recall is better than rereading, which is a study technique that a lot of students report doing. The purpose of this one might be to explore whether immediate feedback improves learning outcomes better than delayed feedback, or maybe what the trade-off is between immediate feedback and delayed feedback. The purpose of our 2x2 design that we discussed might be to explore how preparatory learning experiences change what students can learn from in a passage or a lecture. The answer to this why question is usually found somewhere in the introduction. Now, sometimes you have to wade through a lot of background information just to find it, but it's worth figuring out. Another natural question to ask is, what happened? If you're not really sure what happened, then it becomes difficult to go to the next step, which is interpreting what all of this means. So as I'm reading a paper, I'm trying to answer the big question of what happened with a bunch of smaller questions. Questions like, who are their participants? How are they grouped? What was the difference between the conditions? How did they measure learning outcomes? In the kinds of experiments we're talking about, most of the participants are Western college students. That's good to keep in mind. Grouping can happen in several different ways. Now, we can randomize people into groups like we talked about earlier. You can also try to create balanced groups if randomization is not an option. Or you can take advantage of some existing group structure. There might be two classes that are taught by the same teacher, and you can have students in one class do one thing and in another class do something different. Randomization offers the strongest comparisons, all else being equal, but either way, you need to understand how the grouping was done to make any kind of assessment of the evidence. In some cases, observational researchers try to mimic what would happen in an experiment by trying to create balanced groups based on the data that they have on their participants. I'm going to get to measuring learning outcomes a little bit later on in the video. To get a better understanding of what happened, I like to ask another question. What is the experience of a research participant in this study? So I imagine that I am a research participant. I see a pamphlet in the bathroom recruiting me to the study. I sign up and I show up to the experiment. What happens first? What happens next? What am I hearing and doing and feeling? You can use the same kind of technique for thinking about applied studies. So if a study takes place in a classroom, for instance, imagine you're a student in the class. You show up to class that day. What happens to you? And what do you experience, and what do you feel, and what are you seeing, and what are you doing? All of these things. This exercise helps you to ferret out differences between the researcher's perspective on what the participant is doing and the participant's perspective on what the participant is doing. It's also just a good way of checking whether you actually understand what happened. Looking at data visualizations is another great way of understanding what happened. You will probably come across two different kinds of visualizations. One describes the general situation or the context, and these are probably going to come up in the methods section. You might see a figure summarizing the demographic data about the participants. Or maybe it's about the experimental design itself, kind of all the different activities that happened. Or maybe it's about some aspect of the materials that the students were working with. The other kind of data visualization summarizes the results of the experiment. Usually you see these in the results section or in the discussion section. They can be pretty challenging to understand, especially if they summarize a lot of data at once, or maybe you're not very familiar with the statistical analyses that they're doing, but it's really critical to understand them, and I tend to spend a lot of time just looking at the graph and trying to figure out what it all means. And one of the ways to read complex figures is to pick one data point on the graph and just ask yourself, what does that one data point mean? And from that one data point, you can start to figure out all the other data points until you have an overall good understanding of what the figure says as a whole. So we've explored the what happened question a bit. Now it's time to talk about a second question. What is the explanation for what happened? When you first start reading about a topic, you're kind of constrained to accept the explanations that researchers give you for what happened, because you don't have any basis to have any other explanation yourself, because you don't really know the area at all. But as time goes on and you get to know the topic a little bit better, you start to come up with explanations as you read through the paper. So as I'm reading, I might be thinking, is this an issue of cognitive load here? Or maybe was the time on task exactly the same? Are there some measurements here that are biasing outcomes in favor of one group or another? One of the most important questions that I ask myself is, how are they measuring learning outcomes? The answer to this question tells me about what happened, but it also tells me about how I should be interpreting what happened. With psychology and cognitive science, we almost always have to take indirect measures of what we are interested in. We can't directly know what's going on in someone's brain most of the time. And so we have to probe what skills and knowledge they have through questions and problems and exercises. And it's easy to mistake one kind of measure for another. For instance, there's a lot of research on note-taking that evaluates the quality of the notes taken, right? How many accurate things were written down? What was missed? This is an interesting metric, and I think it's an important thing to explore, but you have to keep in mind that that is not the same thing as measuring long-term learning outcomes. That's measuring something about the notes. Research on learning apps often tracks engagement, which really just means how much time are you spending with the app. That's an important metric to know, especially from a business perspective, but that is not the same thing as measuring actual learning outcomes. A very common limitation of research on learning is when the researchers do not take delayed measures of learning. They measure learning immediately after the intervention, and that's it. There are a number of instructional approaches that create worse learning outcomes in the short term and better learning outcomes in the long term. Another limitation is a lack of transfer measures. So transfer is what happens when you take something that you learned in one situation and you apply it to a different situation. Now, sometimes it can be a little bit different. Sometimes that situation can be a lot different. The universe of approaches that teaches people effectively to do something exactly how they have been trained to do it is relatively large. But the universe of approaches that help people to apply their knowledge into new situations is relatively small. A well-designed transfer measure is a better test of learning outcomes in most cases than a standard outcome measure that just asks people to do exactly what they have already been practicing doing. Now, research is really a consequence of decisions and trade-offs. And so you have to look and see, well, does it make sense to make this decision? And what's the benefit and what's the cost of, say, having a transfer measure or not having a transfer measure, of having delayed learning measures and not having delayed learning measures. And this comes back to what the researcher is really trying to accomplish. Sometimes it makes sense to just look at immediate learning outcomes, and sometimes it doesn't. The question that you are interested in as the reader is often not the question that the researcher is interested in. For instance, one of my viewers was asking whether spoken recall or written recall has better effects in terms of long-term learning. Both involve remembering everything you can about something. In one case, you're speaking it out loud, and in another case, you're writing it down. Now, no one, as far as I know, has directly answered this question, or there's relatively few research articles that are focused on this question. Rather, people have been interested in the accuracy of spoken recall versus written recall, especially in the context of eyewitness memory and in research methods more generally. So we have to think about how relevant is that research to our question. Our question is different than their question, but we can still learn something about our question because their research is probing the cognitive mechanisms that are underlying spoken free recall and written free recall. Notice that as we are answering these questions, we're jumping around a lot. That's because the information that we want is distributed throughout the paper. There are certainly times when I sit down and deeply read a paper from start to finish, but that usually only happens if I think it's a really great paper and it's on a topic that I don't know very well, or if it's written by someone that I know is just really good and I know I'm gonna love to read it. Some of the best papers to read if you're first getting into a topic are not specific experiments, but are summaries or critiques of groups of experiments studying the same question. This gives you some sense of the space that researchers are working in. What has really animated the researchers, and what's the conversation that's happening? How much do they know? And how has knowledge about the phenomenon impacted how they go about researching the phenomenon? I've included a couple of my favorites of this style of paper in the description below. Finally, I just want to say that it's perfectly normal to feel lost when you are reading research. It's good to get lost in the woods sometimes. You just gotta keep looking for those ways out. If this video was helpful to you, feel free to like it. And if you want more videos on reading and understanding research, feel free to let me know in the comments. I'm happy to make them. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.